It's Lac Operon Part 3, and I am all out of witty opening lines. So, hi, biology friends. It's Sarah, your other biology professor, and let's talk about mutations in the Lac Operon. So, like I said, this is essentially Lac Operon Part 3. In the first video, we looked at the structure of the Lac Operon and how lactose availability impacts expression. And in the second video, we looked at catabolite repression, the role of glucose in regulating Lac Operon. So check out those two videos if you need a little bit of review on either of those areas. So now we're ready to see how mutations impact expression of the Lac Operon genes. But first, a little bit of housekeeping. So here we've got the Lac Operon and its regulatory sequences, and that should look very familiar to you. So generally, when you're working problems with Lac Operon mutations, you're going to see the components of the Lac Operon written out sort of in order, I-P-O-Z-Y-A. The plus signs that you're seeing on all those letters indicate that these are wild type alleles. These are the typical alleles with the kind of functionality that you saw when you learned about the Lac Operon in the first place. When you've got a mutation, you may see that indicated with a minus sign. That indicates a null allele or a loss of function allele. Other mutations are indicated with a letter in superscript, and we'll see a few examples of those as well. Mutations in the Lac structural genes are probably the easiest ones to think about, so let's start at the end with those. In a scenario where lactose is available, you would expect that the Lac operon would be expressed and those structural genes would be transcribed and their products would be produced. However, Z minus indicates that we have a mutation in the Lac Z gene. A loss of function or a null mutation means that we're either not producing any product at all, or the beta galactosidase that is produced is non-functional. Y minus means a non-functional or absent permease, and A minus, well, you get the idea, but a lot of classes just leave this one off due to the fuzziness about the role of Lac A's product in lactose metabolism. In practice problems, these are often treated as independent mutations, so an issue with one wouldn't necessarily impact another. However, in reality, because these are produced as a single transcript, issues with transcription, so for example, a mutation that caused early transcriptional termination of beta-galactosidase, would mean that the downstream genes Lac Y and Lac A would be affected. Mutations in the Lac Operon regulatory sequences are going to impact whether expression actually occurs from the Lac Operon, whether it's transcribed. And we can categorize these mutants as non-inducible or constitutive. Let's look at some non-inducible mutations. Hopefully you remember that the Lac Operon is an inducible operon. Its default state is in the off position, but it can be induced, transcription can be turned on, when lactose is available. However, there are some mutations that arise that make it so the Lac Operon cannot be induced, even if there's plenty of lactose. Here's a few that you're likely to encounter. P minus, this indicates a mutation in the promoter. So this mutation means that the sequences in the promoter have been mutated, they've been altered, such that RNA polymerase isn't going to recognize and bind to the promoter to initiate transcription, even if there's no repressor there binding the operator and it's got a nice clear path. I with an S in superscript indicates a super repressor. The super repressor is mutated in a way that it does not bind to the inducer anymore. It no longer recognizes and binds to allolactose. That means that this repressor cannot be inactivated, even if there's plenty of allolactose around in order to do that. The super repressor remains in an active state all the time, sitting on the operator and blocking the initiation of transcription. Other types of mutations in regulatory components can result in a Lac operon that is constitutively expressed, always expressed, unable to be repressed regardless of the levels of lactose that are around. Now, under what lactose conditions would you expect the lac operon to be repressed? No lactose, right? But if you've got an I minus mutation, that's a null lac repressor mutation, that means that that sequence is either producing no repressor at all or one that does not recognize the operator sequence. So even when lactose is not available, RNA polymerase is gonna keep transcribing from this lac operon because there's no repressor blocking it. Now, a similar dynamic, but sort of the other side of the coin here, is the OC, or constitutive operator mutation. Now the problem is in the operator. The operator sequence has been mutated in a way such that the repressor doesn't recognize it and can't bind to it in order to block RNA polymerase from initiating transcription. The name constitutive in constitutive operator is a nice clue that we're not going to get any repression out of this guy. Now that you've seen all these mutations, let's double the fun. So an important tool in studying the lac operon is the use of partial diploids, using plasmids or other means in order to introduce an additional copy of the lac operon that has different functionality than the sequences on the bacterial chromosome. Because we're not duplicating the entire bacterial genome, the entire chromosome, just the lac operon genes, these are called partial diploids, and you may also see the term merozygote to describe this dynamic. The genotypes for partial diploids are often written with a slash in between to sort of separate what's on the bacterial chromosome from the lac operon on the plasmid, or you may see them written one on top of the other. Like we did with those haploids earlier, we're going to look at a few examples of mutations and we'll predict the outcomes of those mutations based on lactose availability. But with partial diploids comes the added complication of having another copy of the lac operon. So we're gonna have to think, which copy is gonna be affected by the mutation? One or both? So in our first example, we have a partial diploid with this genotype and lactose is available. Will the lac operon be induced? So first off, find the mutation. What's the mutation here? P minus, we've got a promoter mutation. And what does that mean? That means that the promoter is busted. RNA polymerase isn't going to be able to recognize it in order to initiate transcription. So if one copy of the lac operon has that busted promoter, that's only going to impact transcription from that copy of the lac operon. The other copy has a fully functional promoter. RNA polymerase will have no trouble binding to that when it's appropriate in order to initiate transcription. So we could call this a cis-acting mutation. Cis-acting mutations affect only the sequence that they're found on. And you're going to see that this is going to be the case for promoter mutations, operator mutations, and mutations in the structural genes. Will the lac operon be induced? Sure, you can still transcribe from the sequence with the wild type promoter. Lactose is available, so we would expect that the lac operon would be induced here, and the bacteria will produce the products of the structural genes. And note that we've got one wild type promoter here and one null promoter here. And the phenotype that we're seeing is expression, induced lac operon, just like what you'd expect to see from a wild type. That means that the P minus mutation is recessive to the wild type. That's right, with two copies of the lac operon, that means we've got two alleles, means we've got some dominant and recessive dynamics to think about. So here we have a new partial diploid with this genotype, and lactose is available. Will the lac operon be induced? First off, what's the mutation? Well, hopefully you notice that our promoters are back to normal here, but now we have an issue with one of the repressors. We've got an IS. That's the super repressor mutation. So what does that mean? Well, a super repressor, hopefully you remember, cannot bind to the inducer, lactose or allolactose. So what does it do instead? It stays on the operator. Which operator though? We've got two. Both. Remember, proteins can diffuse. So the super repressor is going to bind to both of the operators that are present. It's going to repress both copies of the Lac operon. So even though we have a functional copy of the Lac I gene that's going to be popping out functional copies of the Lac repressor, both copies of the Lac operon here are going to be repressed by super repressor proteins. This is a transacting mutation. So transacting mutations can impact any and all copies of the Lac operon. And because I love to complicate things, we've got a wild type repressor allele here, as well as a super repressor allele here. But what phenotype do we see? We see the phenotype caused by the super repressor allele, right? Repression of the Lac operon in the presence of lactose when it shouldn't be repressed. So that means that that super repressor mutation is dominant over the normal wild type repressor. All right, let's do one more, and I'm going to throw a couple of mutations at you for this one. So we have a partial diploid with this genotype, and lactose is not available this time. No lactose. Will the Lac operon be expressed? Now, I know with no lactose, we wouldn't expect it to be, but let's see. Don't get overwhelmed. Check out each sequence, identify the mutations, and think about which copies of the Lac operon are going to be impacted. So one sequence has a P minus and a Z minus mutation, while the other sequence has an I minus and an OC. Now you've seen P minus already from an example, so you remember hopefully that that is a promoter mutation. RNA polymerase is not going to be able to hop on that and initiate transcription regardless of what the lactose levels are doing. So we're not getting any transcription out of that sequence, and so it doesn't really matter that the beta-galactosidase gene is also busted. All right, now what's going on the other sequence? We've got a null repressor mutation, I minus. So that means that we are making a repressor that cannot bind the operator. But we've got a functional copy of the repressor coming from the other Lac operon. So in this scenario with no lactose available, we're still going to be able to produce functional wild-type repressor that'll be able to bind to the operator and repress transcription. So the I minus mutation is recessive to the wild type repressor. What else is happening on the second copy that we haven't talked about yet? The constitutive operator, right? The constitutive operator, that's our unbindable operator. It's got a mutation, that means it's not recognized by repressor protein. An unbound constitutive operator keeps the path open for RNA polymerase to transcribe the structural genes even in the absence of lactose. The more you can practice with the Lac operon mutations, the easier they'll get. But here's a few tips. Really know how the operon works under the normal conditions. Know how those wild type alleles function to regulate expression of the Lac operon. Take your time and identify every mutation that's present, because it's really easy to accidentally miss one of those minus signs. If you can draw out the Lac operon on your test paper, that can be incredibly helpful. And for partial diploids, think about whether the mutation is cis-acting or trans-acting. Which copy or copies of the Lac operon are going to be impacted by that mutation? And with two copies of the Lac operon, that means you've got two copies of the alleles for each of the Lac operon genes and regulatory sequences. Some mutations will be dominant and some will be recessive. Which phenotypes do you see? Now, if you're realizing that you might want a little bit more practice with the Lac operon, hop back to one of the other two videos. But if you're done for today, give me a like if you learned something about Lac operon mutations. Subscribe for more biology content from me and check out my website for tutoring resources. And I will see you next time. Bye.